Okay, we're going to get started. I'd like to echo my thanks to the organizers and especially to a friend of all of ours, Mr. Graham, for giving us this opportunity to participate in this event and share the complimentary reaction to the earlier panels. I feel very fortunate that Mr. Graham gave me the opportunity to try and identify some of the people to discuss the topic we're going to cover today, which is really more of a conduct of hostilities or in bello focus, so to complement the last panel, and specifically the challenges of translating what we might call traditional rules to the type of conflicts that the men and women in uniform in this room are dealing with on a daily basis, which are complicated to say the least. I feel especially fortunate to be up here with three great colleagues of distinguished background. You can read their bios. I think most of you know them. But more importantly, three people that I can call very, very dear friends. Rich Gross this morning was talking about, we were talking about how his son just got engaged. And I remembered when I found out his son was forthcoming right before the side straddle hop at a PT formation at Fort Campbell, probably in 1993. And Ken Watkin and I go back where we first met when he came to a course at the JAG School in 1996. Mike Meier and I have been friends since we worked together when he was at Chairman's Legal, and I was in the job that he's in now for the Army as both members of the Law of War Working Group. So these are not just people who I respect because of their expertise and experience. They're people that I genuinely call good friends, and I appreciate all of your being willing to come and help out with our topic. So we're going to try and follow a format where I propose to each of the panelists a couple of questions, asked each of them to take a lead on some of them. But to set the stage, one of the issues I think we all have complete consensus on is that the conflicts that we are dealing with now, the conflicts that are addressed in the topic of the symposium, are non-international armed conflicts. That may seem somewhat obvious or axiomatic, but many of us remember when the post 9/11 era began, and that was not as easy an assertion to make, because we had all been in kind of this assumption that armed conflicts had to either be international or internal under the rubric of non-international armed conflicts. And the phrase transnational armed conflict, which is commonly used I think today in the discourse and even in judicial opinions, government opinions, was something relatively new. And I'm not sure that the phrase was coined in a footnote to an article I did on snipers in a minaret in Iraq, where I was simply trying to identify a term that everybody could agree to that would indicate that you were in fact in a non-international armed conflict outside your own national territory, which was a complicated proposition to assert. Today, that's an accepted reality, and I posed the question to the panelists last night. I found out that a couple of them were at dinner, so they abated their answer. But is there any plausible theory to argue that the conflict against ISIS is anything other than a non-international armed conflict? And not only did I get a rapid negative response from the panelists, but even Mr. Graham, who was CC'd on the email, said it's basically straightforward. We're dealing with a non-international armed conflict. So that's our kind of legal framework that we're operating under. And then what becomes challenging, I think, is how do we address some of the issues that would be simplified in an interstate armed conflict when we're dealing with a non-international armed conflict? And I'm going to start with Brigadier General Watkin, and focus specifically on the people part. We've heard some discussion this morning about targeting and the parties involved in conflict, but how do we characterize the enemy we're dealing with? In my view, we deal with two broad schools of thought. Maybe in the end the outcome is the same, but there's a school of thought that there is in fact what we might call a third category of participants in the battle space, the unprivileged belligerent, a member of an organized armed group that doesn't qualify for POW status but is not a civilian, versus the camp that says you're either a combatant or a civilian. Now, if you're a civilian, you can lose your protection as a result of direct participation in hostilities. I've always viewed the former theory as more maybe operationally and tactically sound, but I'd like you to start us off with a discussion of that question. Okay.
Well, actually, I'd like to start just by echoing the comments and saying what a pleasure it is to be here. The first law of armed conflict course I ever took was in 1983, and you folks had law of armed conflict courses here, and we didn't. And so we used to send our officers down here. And, of course, I got to come back again in 96 or 97 for the two-week national security law program that ran in the summer at University of Virginia, and it was just a wonderful program. Another sort of thing to start with is David Graham sent out a reference to a Washington Post article talking about possible changes to rules of engagement. And it says, Trump also ordered recommendations to change any existing military rules of engagement that are more stringent than what is required by international law. There's both a positive and a concerning element to that. The positive element is the reference to it's going to be governed by international law under the new administration. And I only say that because, to put this in context, if we were, you know, sitting in my office 16 years ago, there were some very serious discussions about what the U.S. was doing and what its commitment was to international law. And that can make it, you know, what international law applied or didn't, where the sources of law were going to apply to our new actors, that can make it very challenging to be an ally. And so, you know, what a state is going to do is they're going to say, well, we'll keep true to what we believe it is. And quite frankly, the discussion we had in my office was, it's a great democracy and it has a great Supreme Court and they will sort it out. And if you go to the Hamden decision, ultimately that's what happened. So when I go talk to my UK colleagues, I tell them we share the same monarch, but we don't have the same legal system and necessarily, and we're certainly not bound by the European Court of Human Rights. So states will look at these issues differently from their own experience. What I've put up here is your definition from the U.S. Military Commissions Act. And I guess the question I pose for you is, if you were an outside observer, what would you believe the U.S. view is to who is a valid target? Well, is this a definition of who a valid target is? And what does material support mean after the Holder decision in terms of the breadth of this? Of course, the U.S. Commissions Act is focused on detainees in trial, right? But the U.S. Commissions Act is also the only place I've been able to find that has a legislative basis for war sustaining, which is, you know, targeting the banks and the money depots and the oil producing facilities in Iraq. So for an outside observer, you could struggle a little bit to find out what the legal basis is of a state in terms of how broadly they're targeting. So on top of the whole issue of the international concerns about whether there is a right to strike outside hot battlefields or active battlefields, there's also the question of the concern of what the breadth is of who is a valid target. The broader you make a unprivileged belligerent as a target, the less chance you're going to have civilian casualties. The narrower that is, then you may have a broader number of civilian casualties. And Ryan Goodman, Gabor Rona, and Steve Pomper have been having an engagement in the last few days on just security, where this is one of the issues that's been raised in terms of a skepticism by some as to how many civilian casualties there are and how you define them. You can go to the military, law of armed conflict manual, and it has a lot of great things in there in terms of general discussions. It's largely focused by the DPH study and a reaction to the ICRC DPH study, which many of us view as far too narrow. So it gives a broader view of who might fall within the definition, including things like same function that is performed in a regular armed forces, combat support, or combat service support function. Well, what does that mean for an armed group? How do you equate that in terms of a non-state actor? There is a lot of unknowns. What does material support mean here? And when you put it in practical terms, it wasn't so long ago, 2009, where there was a very serious discussion within NATO about targeting Taliban drug dealers in Afghanistan. And the question is whether Taliban drug dealers were unprivileged enemy belligerents. I think they would have been, arguably under this definition, but there was considerable pushback in terms of what the international community felt was the definition of an unprivileged belligerent, or whatever you want to call it.
But you would concede that you cannot ipso facto extrapolate from the fact that they're using this as a detention standard, that it is the definitive definition of who the enemy fighter is.
Right. And so from my perspective, that's what it is. And I don't believe the targeting that's going on is that broadly framed. The question is, in the debate that is going on publicly over what is a lawful target and who are civilians that are being killed, where is the specificity being provided that would show that that's narrowed? Or where is there a public statement, even in the various U.S. documents, to say this is solely for the basis of trial under the U.S. Commissions Act and not a definition for targeting purposes? That targeting might be much narrower. Because this raises questions of who falls within the envelope. So one of the concerns I used to have in our armed forces when we were talking about targeting is people would talk about the Taliban. Well, my question is, no, it's the armed group that we're targeting. So is everyone in the Taliban a member of their armed group? Is everyone in Al-Shabaab a member of the armed group? And if you're the Islamic State and you're trying to pretend you're a state or operate like a state, you're inviting engineers, you're inviting financiers in, you're trying to run a government, is everyone that works for the Islamic State a valid target? Because they're a member of the organized armed group.
So my question, I think, and the question that the hardest question, we know that status-based targeting is a presumptive-based rule. You wear a uniform, you have a status, you're presumptively a threat. You don't, you're a civilian, you're presumptively inoffensive. Neither presumption is conclusive. They're both rebuttable. But what it does affect is the burden. So if I'm a soldier and you're in uniform, you bear the burden of rebutting the presumption. I can act on the presumption. If the enemy you're fighting basically dilutes the ability to engage in that type of presumptive attack decision making, have they won an unjustifiable windfall by essentially making every targeting judgment conduct based, which constantly puts the burden on the law abiding force to make the fact-based judgment? Because if you say, well, how do you know which members of this group are part of the belligerent group, it sounds like you have to treat it as if they're all not, and then you have the burden of justifying every attack judgment.
And I do not think they're all conduct-based. I think the question of the organized armed group is a valid concern. You can go to additional protocol 2, and you find the wording right there, and I'm a proponent of that. Certainly the combat function test was an early proponent of that term, which got picked up by the Israeli Supreme Court, which worked its way into the DPH study that was narrowed with continuous combat function. I guess the concern I have is that presumes that states always fight in uniform, or states always employ organizations which fall within the armed forces. And we know clearly that isn't the case. It isn't the case historically, going back, World War II and before, and it isn't the case now. And so there, sometimes even if you're fighting another state, part of the conduct, you're going to have to use a conduct-based criteria to understand whether they fall within the armed group that, meet the status. So you can argue putting on a uniform is a form of conduct, right?
So, Mike, Ken raised the issue of targeting resources, war-sustaining resources. It was brought up a couple of times today, attacking money and the whole discussion of whether money, when you're dealing with a non-state group, should be treated differently than you're dealing with a group that is subject to IEPA or OFAC or something like that. And I've asked you to give some thought to the U.S. approach to dealing with resources as a potential object of attack.
Thanks, Geoff. And first, like, join others and thank the organizers for inviting us down today. As the one panel member that's still part of the U.S. government, like others, I have to sort of give my disclaimer that, again, the views are mine alone. I think Carl Chain sort of explained this pretty well, that anything I say that's correct, the Department of Defense will be happy to jump on those. And anything that I say that the Department of Defense disagrees with, like the guys in Mission Impossible, I have been disavowed and I'm out there on my own. So that's my disclaimer. Colonel Pat Houston talked a little bit about the, I think, the war-sustaining targeting that they're doing. Certainly, I agreed with the comment that he had this morning, is that I don't think the United States believes categorically that we can target, you know, any cash revenue-generating object just simply because of their nature. So I think you have to look back to whether, you know, just simply the principal distinction. Is it a civilian object or is it a military objective? And then you just look at the definition and this sort of the two parts. You know, does it by its nature, location, purpose, or use make an effective contribution to military action? So that's the first part. And I think in the case of ISIS and the petroleum aspect and then the bulk cash, I think that's where the distinction comes in, because it is making an effective contribution to the military action. ISIS doesn't have the ability to print its own money. It's not like the U.S. government where we do it. So it is a cash-based business, as Colonel Houston pointed out. And that money goes directly to paying its fighters. It goes directly to buying weapons. So, I mean, there is a effective contribution to that military action. And same thing with the oil. You know, they're selling the oil specifically to raise funds for buying ammo, weapons, and other supplies for the fight. And then you get to the second part, whether the destruction offers a definite military advantage. And again, it goes to you can't have sort of speculative or indirect sort of gains or indeterminate gains. You'd have to show that how it has the definite military advantage of taking this. And because it does rely on the petroleum and the cash, I think the view has been that it's not speculative or indeterminate. And when they've you can see that through the results of the targeting. You know, once the cash bulk sites were destroyed, they've had to reduce salaries to their fighters. Once you've taken out the petroleum exports, I mean, people refer to ISIS as the richest terrorist organization in the world. They were generating anywhere up to $1 billion a year with these things. And with the destruction, that has been cut in half or more. And so you can see that it's directly impacted how ISIS has been able to fight. And I think that's how you have to look at that. And it becomes, I think the farther you get into the speculative nature of the target you're going to attack, the less likely it's going to meet the military objective standard.
So I guess the question that raises in my mind, and I know that Ken has written about this issue on just security and been somewhat critical of treating money as a target, is whether the non-state nature of the enemy, and this is for all of you, whether the non-state nature of the enemy is a relevant consideration when assessing what might otherwise be an impermissible means or method of warfare in an international armed conflict. For example, I was at one meeting where Yoram Dinstein, in the way he likes to point things out, emphasizes that international law recognizes there's a way to deprive an enemy of resources, blockade. Right? But then the question becomes, when you're dealing with an enemy, as the colonel said this morning, that's not amenable to things like asset forfeiture, freezing of assets, financial controls, blockade, so forth, does that justifiably expand the scope of what then becomes a permissible military objective because of the effect that you need to produce on the enemy? Anybody?
Well, I mean, one of the things it does is from a practical standpoint, it makes it harder to distinguish. And so, for example, if we had someone moving large amounts of cash, you know, they might be a U.S. Treasury employee, you know, a little bit of a bizarre hypothetical, and they'd be in a civilian truck, and they're clearly not a combatant because we distinguish. We might have, on the other hand, a finance officer in a military uniform with a military vehicle moving military cash, and so there, it's very easy to distinguish there, and we do that. We have military officers and NCOs in combat zones moving large amounts of cash around. They're combatants. They're lawful targets, and they know that. So we obviously protect them. And so the enemy, on the other hand, doesn't have that distinction. They don't have a Department of Treasury, you know, is easily distinguishable. And so it makes it harder to say, okay, that's clearly a civilian arm of ISIS doing civilian things. Whereas it would be very easy with us to be able to distinguish between the two. And that, as a practical matter.
How do you react to the slippery slope concern that Ken raises, which is, well, then why isn't the poppy field in Afghanistan a lawful military?
The last refuge of the academic, right. The slippery slope. Right. We all know that phrase. Yeah. And so the practitioner's last refuge, it's a case-by-case basis. You have to go and analyze. I know we from a practical standpoint, the poppy fields in Afghanistan were virtually off limits. There weren't, most of the, not only under NATO ISAF rules, but most of the nations said, unless we can show a nexus between a combatant activity, we're not just going to go target poppy fields because it's criminal. And most of the nations, to include us, were pretty clear that there was a good separation between criminal activity and combatant activity. But it does get a little murky when the Taliban's running that and using that to directly finance their operations. I'll give you that.
Cool. Yeah. And Ryan's written a lot on this, and I think chair. he and I would part company a little bit in terms of how broadly accepted this notion that you can target the financial proceeds. And we're talking a very narrow thing in some ways. Yeah. The financial proceeds that you get from selling oil or selling drugs or whatever now becomes targetable because you use it to run your war effort. And I think that doesn't fall within the AP1, Additional Protocol 1, notion of targeting. I think Ryan probably disagrees with me, but that's where the debate is. I think then there's a more interesting question. If you don't agree with it, what's the consequences of doing it if you look through the mirror of reciprocity? And so if you're setting this standard, in some ways intuitively it's easier to say with the Islamic State, you know, it's a genocidal evil group that it's easy to sort of think that you should broaden your ability to get them. But if you're setting a course of action that you're relying on broad principles of international law, then you should be prepared to counter them against yourself. And I think this is what's led to the issue of, well, it was just a money depot, as we heard in the money depot that the Islamic State was using, as opposed to the banks, right? So we're starting to divide up the money. The problem is money is so fungible, you know, it's the heartbeat of terrorism, but it's also the heartbeat of our societies. And especially in a cyber environment, my concern is when an enemy thinks that maybe we should attack the economic power of the United States and Wall Street, because that's ultimately the money that's used. The other piece that doesn't happen...
So that's your slippery slope.
It's my slippery slope, but it's also about dialogue. So there's very much in terms of the reason we're doing this is to degrade the Islamic State's ability to fund their effort, which I think intuitively makes sense to everyone. What there isn't a discussion is, what's the collateral effects on the civilian population that's trying to live under a regime which no longer has the money to finance it, to have food, to run those sorts of things. So that's part of the challenge. It's only part of the dialogue makes its way into the public dialogue in the papers.
Well, that was actually one of the questions that I asked you to address based on an article that you wrote recently, which is whether or not we are, as a general rule, we are adequately considering the effect on civilian population in the military advantage equation, right? It seems to me that what you're suggesting is if you're considering attacking the money without considering the second and third order consequences of the civilian population, you might be missing an important component of military objective analysis. Have I misstated it?
Kind of foreseeability?
Yeah, I focus it more narrowly. I think there's a broader question of the nature of counterinsurgency
okay.
in terms of how it plays out. So I'll just bring another.
Happen to have a slide.
Happen to have a slide, yeah, to get ready. I'm a visual learner, so that's my challenge. You know, there is this debate about what is military advantage versus the collateral civilian impact. And in the military, we talk about in my research, I've only ever been able to find in doctrine a definition of high-value targets. I've never been able to find a doctrine of low-value targets or medium-value targets. And if you're so, we expect to fight in a high-value target-rich environment, I guess. But this causes the notion in my mind of what is a military advantage, and is it always just in terms of, as the ICRC would say, soldiers killed, ground taken, military objectives killed, or is there something far more important and nuanced to that? And so from my perspective from counterinsurgency, there has to be a military advantage to not isolating the civilian population. Military commanders do that all the time. They both design their operations and they make targeting decisions based on how many civilians they're going to kill. And where this arises in my, is this dialogue that's happened in the public realm of zero casualties. Any civilian casualty, it's almost a human rights standard, is problematic. But I think there's a strong argument that legally in a counterinsurgency environment, there's a narrower acceptance of proportionality at law. And this gets to the debate of, is the decision to scale back our operations and targeting a requirement at law or a requirement of policy? And when you talk to most state legal advisors, they will say, well, that's a policy decision. But it's almost framed in terms of what we know the law, do we know what the law is in terms of this scope. It seems to me that if you're trying to avoid civilian casualties, and that's to a military advantage, that has to work to narrow the acceptable range at law of civilian casualties. So I go to the targeted killing case, which introduced this notion of a zone of proportionality that's framed by weighing these two things. And within this zone, you find the point of what might be excessive or not. And so theoretically, on what construct, is there a very broad zone where you will accept there's more casualties are allowed? Is it the shoot down of an aircraft over North America? And on what, at law, is that a legal question of what's acceptable? It seems to me it is. If you can accept a large number of casualties, at law, under what circumstances will you only accept a narrow number of casualties and what are the factors that come to play? And at law, it's got to be military advantage weighed against what the casualties are.
So Rich, what do you think? The theory that your military advantage is actually enhanced by reducing civilian casualties, which constricts, as a matter of law, the scope of permissible casualties in your proportionality equation, or you operated under the tactical directives.
Yeah, I mean, we kind of took that into account. I don't, you know, and I just don't, I'd have to give it a lot of thought to know if that's a principle in law versus just commanders making good decisions. And so certainly we saw that in a counterinsurgency, and I had this discussion often with NGOs who were very excited, and human rights organizations, very excited about the tactical directive, very excited about the fact that, you know, we were doing everything we could to reduce civilian casualties down to virtually nothing if we could in a counterinsurgency. And I was quick to explain and maybe burst bubbles sometimes at saying, look, there's no guarantee we would ever enact a tactical directive in an environment where it was traditional nation state on nation state warfare, because then there is no hearts and minds consideration, the things that Ken's talking about, you know, that certainly you have your normal rules of proportionality, and any loss of civilian life is tragic, but it less contributes to your winning the conflict. In a counterinsurgency, he's right. I mean, the fewer civilian casualties, the more likely the civilian population is going to support the government and the nation supporting that government, and the more likely you'll bring that counterinsurgency conflict to an end. On the other hand, if you're in traditional nation state on nation state warfare, it doesn't factor in the same ways. Now,
I mean, I think it's a really fascinating element of applying the proportionality concept, because normally what we're doing is we're balancing military advantage, but when you make reducing civilian casualties
part
a military advantage, it fundamentally alters the scope of what you start out with an assumption you should be trying to make.
Yeah, it's almost like you weigh it twice.
Right.
It factors in on military advantage, and then it factors in again on the proportionality balancing. And you know, I just don't know. I don't know. I'd have to. I mean, it's a fascinating thought, and I think at some level, at a practical matter, it's done. Commanders are doing that. They don't have to be told it's the law. They know in a counterinsurgency it matters. The more interesting thing is, does it matter in counterterrorism, for example, where obviously we have the very high standards that the previous panel talked about. Does it matter? Because some will tell you it absolutely does, that every time there's a drone strike and we kill civilians, that we just made it worse in that area, that we just created more terrorists, so we're actually going backwards. And other people will say it just doesn't matter. I mean, it matters in the sense that you've killed civilians. Don't misstate. But it doesn't affect the conflict itself. That it does in the scheme of things, every terrorist you take out, is a step towards winning that fight.
Mike, did you want to comment?
Yeah, I kind of agree with Rich. I don't know if it changes the proportionality and the military objective analysis from a legal matter. I do think it gets into the strategic objective of what you're trying to achieve. In the counterinsurgency aspect, I mean, I think that's where we've talked about earlier today and others. You start then mixing the policy aspect and the strategic objective of trying to end the conflict while still applying the legal matter. But I don't know if it narrows the proportionality analysis. I think that's being weighed in with the goal of limiting civilian casualties.
And I think this plays, Geoff, into highlights, I think, something you've written a fair bit about, which is what's the nature of the targeting rules that are found in Additional Protocol 1, Article 57? The international community focuses on the outcome. Is it proportionality? Mm-hmm. And the problem with this is, how do you define that? It's mixing apples and oranges, and you're trying to reach an outcome which is acceptable. Historically, it's a morality test, double effect, medieval doctrine, double effect, that's been put in a legal rule and has become an international crime. But the question is, how do you do the outer bounds? And as you've identified, and others are starting to write about, is that perhaps the most important part of the test in Additional Protocol 1 is the process part that comes in terms of the weighing, not the final outcome, but the requirement to avoid or minimize civilian casualties, which forces commanders to sit down and say, what is the advantage that I want to have, and how will I conduct my operations that the outcome will be I get to a happy place, morally, legally, or whatever. And so it's in many respects, it's that process that gets you to the place of comfort and gets you to the place to be able to explain where you end up, as I put up here, like the Israeli High Court has said, you still end up with a zone. And this is where it separates, in many respects, from parts of the human rights community that want no collateral damage, whereas even in a counterinsurgency, this process is going to leave you with that possibility because that's the reality of the beast. But you're in a happy place getting there in terms of meeting the moral and legal requirements.
And it was one of the issues that I specifically asked Rich to address, so I'm going to ask you in a moment. But one thing I think that is very interesting is when I hear academic conferences and I hear discussions about transparency, right? Why don't we know? I mean, I'll never forget when I was sitting next to Rosa Brooks. I think you were in the audience. We were testifying on the AUMF, and I think Carl Levin said, how do we know who an enemy combatant is, who can be attacked by a drone? And Rosa said, I don't know, and I think we should know, and I really want to know. And then he said, well, what do you think, Professor Corn? I said, I really want to know, too. I don't think I should because I don't have a top secret clearance, but I really would like to know, right? And so instinctively for me, I think maybe I have more confidence in the conclusion that we're acting within that zone of reasonableness. And I think that's because I am aware of the process. Yeah. And the process is the manifestation of good faith commitment to the end state, right? And so I like your thoughts. I know you wanted to make a comment, but specifically, we fight enemies that are deliberately violating the law, mm-hmm. and yet we know that in our process we're becoming that much more cautious. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, and the point I wanted to make back on your conversation with Ken just now, because you've written on it, and I think you were the first to write on it, and then others like Lori Blank have written on it. We somewhat in the minds, I think, of the public and the person who doesn't study in this area, they've reduced proportionality to a post-strike, what was the actual damage? And I think that's dangerous for us as a military. It's dangerous for us as a country or countries, because the test is what the commander knew and was his decision reasonable about the foreseeable casualties that might come from a particular strike. And we have to judge based on that. And judging based on the post-strike, you know, there were three kids in there. Well, if the commander didn't know there were three kids in there and it was proportional based on what he or she knew and they went through the right process and watched it, I mean, we go to tremendous lengths before we take strikes, particularly in places like Yemen, Somalia, Libya, tremendous means of watching. We watch targets for a long, long time.
Do you think that, I'm curious, do you think that the kind of commitment to that process at every level of command over the last 15 to 17 years has grown a different culture of warfighter than we grew up with?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because it was, you know, it was a simplified the process when we were coming up and learning it. And we were thinking in a World War II, you know, I mean, certainly we had Vietnam and Korea, but we were all kind of thinking of the force on force. Here's what's going to happen and doing the math and commander makes the call. And it's become the process now is so sophisticated. I was going back and forth with a really good friend who was at a human rights organization that focuses on civilian casualties. And her concern was that, well, what if you don't know who's in that building? And I said, okay, I can't tell you how long, but how long would you watch a building? How long would you watch a building before you felt comfortable you knew there weren't any civilians in that building? And she said 2 days. And I said, we watch it longer than that. What do you think now? And she got, I mean, her eyes.
Right.
She thought, she assumed we watched it for an hour. Or 2 hours. And I said, we watch it much longer than you think we do. And so, that goes back to your question. Do you trust the process? And I
right.
think the more you've been inside and seen the process, the more you tend to trust it. And I could be wrong, but I think if you've seen it, lived through it, you know how much deliberation there is, how much oversight there is, how many people are involved in those decisions, and so forth.
And I do think that one of the effects that we've not fully grasped is that this emphasis on process and precautions and maybe a more conservative view to the use of combat power is cultivating a different culture within the military itself. The commanders that are going to be taking over in the next 10 to 15 to 20 years have a different understanding. I think it's positive because what I think it does is it reinforces that balance between humanity and necessity that we know is at the core. Yeah.
Yep. I think there's a broader question here, though, and that's these rules may seem new culture. I mean, it's written down is the AP 1, 1977, right? And no one pays attention to this language until after 9/11. But it's not just 9/11. There's also a technological piece to it. So in the intervening time, you've had the beginning of precision-guided missiles. You've got drones. You've got an ability to do this sort of thing. And it seems to me that's interlapping in terms of what the discussion is, right? And so there has been a tremendous change. And if there's any discussion of what the normative impact of treaty law can be, I think it's looking at that targeting discussion that's changed from when we joined the forces. I joined in the 72. There was no additional protocol to what there is now in terms of the dialogue is completely different. The expectations are different. And the challenge is going to be turning it back the other way when we're not fighting conflicts where you can watch a building for 2 hours.
Yeah.
Well,
but we have those now because people are using these rules in self-defense.
There's also a challenge we've seen, and I'm sure some of the uniformed people in the building have confronted, which is, as you say, Rich, an increasing expectation of perfection, right?
Yeah,
the more you talk about your process, the more you talk about your technology, the more you talk about your capability, the lower the tolerance seems to be for error.
Yeah.
Or maybe not even error, right? I mean, I teach criminal procedure, and one of the things I hammer into my students is reasonable doesn't always mean right.
Yeah.
You can make reasonable mistakes, and it certainly occurs in war. One of the issues that's gaining more and more discussion internationally is an obligation to investigate, right? Which I think is very interesting. We've had our DOD Law of War Directive since after the conflict in Vietnam, and we've always been taught that when there's a credible report of a violation, it has to be investigated. What I think has been under-theorized and is very important for the military is what triggers that obligation. How much information, what level of certainty is required? Mike, if you were up at OTJAG and the question is, when am I required to initiate an investigation of a potential violation, what do we say?
I think you go back to when you have a reasonable basis to believe that there's been a law of armed conflict violation. I mean, so that's what we put out in 2311, the DOD directive.
But you know I'm not going to let you – you know what I'm coming back at you with, right? What makes a basis reasonable?
Well, then that's the question. I mean, where do you get the information from? I mean, it's I think Rich probably lived through this when he was in Afghanistan. I mean, you know, who's giving you the information? And, you know, do you have an obligation to go back and take every piece of information that someone gives you? Is that credible?
Is there a chilling effect to over-investigation?
Yeah, I think there would be.
Yes, there is.
Yeah, and I think it goes back to sort of Ken's point and your point earlier is we seem to be getting to where it's almost the zero defect. I mean, you have to be right all the time. It goes back to sort of the way people view these investigations is if somebody mistakenly dies, somebody has to pay. And it gets away from, I think, an armed conflict that, you know, things happen. You know, you never have a perfect picture. And it goes to Rich's point. You can't look after it's happened. You have to look at the information you have available to you at the time. And, you know, did you act in a reasonable manner? You know, things happen in war, you know, and bad things happen. So it's never going to be perfect.
There is an interesting point, though, where there's a chilling effect until you get to a point where you investigate so much that it's routine. And that has its own consequences. We were the point where just about any civilian casualty, even if on face value it looked completely lawful, no question about the ROE, we'd still investigate it. And then typically follow up with some kind of salation or something. That was just kind of the where the atmosphere had gone.
So going back to your comment about the concern over effects-based judgment of military operations, right? All of these things, I think, play into it. One that struck me as I was listening to the colonel's presentation this morning is I asked Ken to give it a little thought. We constantly use the term the obligation to minimize civilian casualties. That unsurprising, it's in the text of Article 57. In the stuff I've been writing, I try and redefine it as mitigation effort, right? So the obligation of the commander is to take all feasible measures to mitigate risk. Because I think mitigation of risk is forward-looking. Minimization of casualties plays into effects-based analysis. And I'm just curious what you guys think about if that terminology that we're even using is subtly contributing to this effects-based critique of military actions.
Yeah, I think it might, actually. And that's a good – I hadn't thought about that. But mitigate is certainly a little less – I think it's a better term than minimize, because minimize assumes you're going to drop it down to zero at some point. And it plays into this effects-based where any casualty is a failure. Somebody has messed up if there's a civilian casualty, and that's not what the law says, and that's not what our policy says. But there certainly seems to be this idea out there that any civilian casualty is now there's something wrong. Somebody messed up.
Ken?
Yeah, I see mitigation as problematic in the sense that it doesn't set out close enough what the desired end state is, and in the law it is to avoid or minimize. Right, so you take mitigating steps to get you to that point. It's the end state which is important. I guess I would put the test this way: does anyone see a scenario where applying the targeting rules, there is a potential military objective which is not worth hitting because it might kill one civilian?
Sure.
The answer to me is sure. Yeah. Right. So, but that you know. That isn't normally the discussion. Well, you would say, I won't hit it today, or I'll hit the target somewhere else. So you do have to consider the avoiding or minimizing, regardless of how you're mitigating. Is just explaining what you're doing to get to the end state. To me,
I see it a little bit differently. In my mind, the value of emphasizing risk mitigation is there are objective measures you take to reduce the risk before you make that ultimate proportionality judgment. To me, you've gone through all the steps, you've got the military objective, and now it's what? It's a place where they store berets for the you know, some guard unit, and you're going to kill a civilian child if you attack it. To me, that now you're down to the ultimate proportionality judgment. But if you've gone through all those steps beforehand to bring it down, I'm not saying that's the ultimate outcome. I also think the value of it, however you characterize it, is I think it's objective evidence of good faith. And I think one of the things we have failed to emphasize in our own, I don't want to use the word marketing, but our own demonstration of our commitment to humanitarian principles in the conduct of counterterrorism or counterinsurgency operations is that behind the scenes we're doing all these things in many ways to offset the risk that the enemy is exacerbating because of its own illicit tactics. Yeah. So you have this irony. Earlier I asked the question, does the nature of your enemy potentially expand the scope of a lawful military objective? I think it cuts both ways. I think the nature of your enemy can actually push more obligation on you to mitigate civilian risk than you might otherwise had if you had a law-compliant enemy, because every attack you conduct, your expectation is they want you to create civilian casualties, right?
Yeah, I mean, in fact, we saw, you know, one of the things, and we were talking about this at lunch, you know, we published our standard that there was near certainty that no noncombatants would be present. And we published that and we spoke about it, and it's in speeches for our counterterrorism strikes outside of Iraq, Afghanistan, and Syria. And by publishing that, I mean, my first thought was, okay, now that we've published that standard, if I'm a terrorist, what am I going to do? I'm going to force a woman to sit in the front seat next to me, and I'm going to have kids in the back seat. Everywhere I go, I'm going to make sure, because we have this no women and children, you know, which is not the legal standard, but that's where folks leap. And so if I were a terrorist, I would drive around in a car with as many civilians as I could put in there. And because we've published a standard that says that's no longer a lawful target.
Right.
And there's a danger there that we've made it harder on ourselves. And so, you know, we at some point we start to look for other ways to get at that individual. And I think in some cases we'd be better off probably not publishing standards like that that are so high and so hard to meet. I'm stunned that we don't see more of the Al-Qaeda and ISIS leaders driving around with folks in the car with them.
So that leads me to one of the wild cards I told you I might throw at you. We know from the report that the article that Dave sent us, you mentioned that the president has suggested that maybe the rules of engagement will simply be comply with the law of armed conflict. Mainly for my American colleagues, do you think the president is legally bound by customary international law? Because if we're talking about NIAC, and we're talking about all these efforts we make as precautionary measures, that's not a treaty obligation, to my knowledge. I mean, I don't see it in Protocol 2, even if you wanted to argue that we're bound to the object and purpose of the treaty because we signed it, and it's certainly not in Common Article 3. We would all probably agree it's a customary international law extension of law that was created for IAC. Is he bound by that? And if you don't want to answer, you can tell me.
Yeah, you might.
Yeah. I would point out that Geoff gave us this question like 30 minutes before we started. So I think you would like to say yes. But I think you go back and look at the Supremacy Clause, and I think people are all over the place about whether, you know, on customary international law, is the president bound by that? I think also the other discussion comes in kind of what I think Deborah and others were talking about is when you say customary international law, you know, do we believe it's customary international law? I mean, has it risen to the level of customary international law? To the article. I mean, you can look at Article 75 we put out a couple years ago where we said we were going to, you know, apply this out of a sense of legal obligation, which indicates that we think at some point it will become customary international law, but we weren't saying at the time that it has achieved that status. So, I mean,
I think most of us thought that debate was put to rest a little bit, right? The post 9/11 debate of whether you're bound by custom. I just wonder if some of that could get resurrected again, and then where are we?
Well, the hard part is, you know, unlike a law that says you will drive 25 miles an hour or less in this area, that's pretty black and white. We know what that says. With customary international law, you know, the president at some level says, I don't think that's the law. I've checked with my advisors and I disagree that that's customary international law. And so that the real problem is, I think he would say, oh, I'm absolutely bound by customary. Well, I don't know what this president would say, but and I'm not making a political statement there. I'm just saying, let's assume he said, absolutely, I'm bound by customary international law. I just don't think that's customary international law in that case. And that's really where the problem is going to be, is, defining what that is.
Okay.
Yeah.
An example, I think, I think before he was elected, I think he said something about, we'll go after, targeting families and other things
right.
like that. I think we would all agree that, again, targeting civilians is a customary international law principle, and you can't do it. You're bound by that.
I think it's more customary.
I don't know how you could, if he came up now and said something like that, well, we're going to now target Al-Qaeda leaders and all their families. I think that would, he's certainly not able to do that.
Another question, somewhat related. We're talking about precautions, and one of the arguments that I hear, or statements I hear, and it's caused me a lot of pause, is the statement that we did more than we were required to, right? So we issued warnings, but we weren't required to, or we attacked at a different time, but we weren't required to. I'm curious what your reaction is to the response. If the obligation is to take all feasible precautions and you did it, doesn't that ipso facto indicate that what you did was feasible?
Feasible, yeah.
I mean, I hear this a lot from my Israeli friends. Are what we really trying to say is that every case of precautions is a case-by-case assessment? So just because we did it yesterday doesn't mean we're always obligated to do it?
Yeah, I mean, if I had to guess, I would say that part of it is kind of reserving that right to do that case-by-case analysis. And, I thought it was interesting in the early days of this current Iraq conflict that one of the U.S. generals in one of his briefings from Iraq mentioned the knock on the roof,
right.
which is the first time we've heard a U.S. person use that about a U.S. operation. So, we're learning from the Israelis. No matter what you think of that technique, it is a way of at least giving some sort of warning. And I have a targeting presentation I do sometimes, and I show some of the flyers we drop on populations, and it shows a fuel truck and an F-15 coming in on low strafe, which is funny, and then little guys running out of the truck, and it's got warning in a couple different languages telling them, hey, you need to abandon your trucks because we're going to target those. And that's an effort to not hurt somebody who, even if arguably you could link that truck driver to close enough to ISIS, say he had a continuous combat function that you thought, or part of an organized armed group, or you think he's a combatant, we still take the precaution to get the driver out of the truck. And so there's a lot of things we do, but often commanders, particularly when surprise is a big element, will not want to do that. Because it could add risk to the mission, it could add risk to the force going in, and frankly add risk that the other side will start moving in the human shields.
So I think there are two kind of risks that we're dealing with. One is the external expectation that because you did it once, you always have to do it, and therefore if you don't do it, you're violating the law,
right.
which could explain why you make that kind of qualifier. The other, though, the flip side of the risk is suggesting that it's always, it's just, we never have to do it.
Yeah.
We did it because we felt like it.
Yeah.
What are you thinking?
Yeah, I think it's the former. I think you're always looking for operational flexibility, right? And the concern is that if you do something this time without a full assessment of what all the factors are,
correct,
you'd be forced to do it again. So a lot of the discussion now about drones is a uniquely American discussion, where you're loitering over for more than 2 days trying to get the pattern of life, PID, positive ID, all of that in terms of taking a strike. When this law has to apply to everything from the individual private soldier to a whole different state-on-state strategic air campaign where effects-based targeting is at the heart of the targeting decisions that are made. And it's these few articles. Most of it's been accepted as customary international law, and so it's managing expectations where people say we did this in order to justify this, and the next time they'll say, well, why didn't you do it this time? Mm-hmm. But there's also plays out just like the major, I forget your name, sorry, question asked about, are we setting a standard by doing these announcements? And I see it with the test for near certainty. that absolutely isn't a test under LOAC or a test under human rights law in terms of decisions to shoot. It's reasonable belief, at which you can have a mistaken belief and be just as you mentioned. But if you're as I understand your policy guidance, it was clear to say this only applies outside of active battlefields, whatever that is.
Well, and it's interesting too. You know, you earlier hearkened to the pronouncement that they're going to take all policy and shrink it, all ROE, and shrink it back down to the limits of international law. And in some cases, you might want to do that. You might want to, near certainty, as Ken's pointed out, that might be a standard you want to bring back to the traditional law of armed conflict standard, and a reasonable certainty kind of standard. And you might be comfortable with that. But then there are other areas of rules of engagement where we've added policy restrictions because they make sense, and because we want to control soldiers' fires, and because we have a good policy reason.
Of course, if you strip that down, then that chart becomes that much more important, right?
Yeah, it could be.
Because then what becomes decisive is the proportionality assessment, and then the factoring in whether or not protecting civilians is actually an element of the military advantage, right?
Yeah.
We had agreed that we wanted to save plenty of time for questions, but just one more question for any of the group or all of you. The ongoing debate related to Common Article 1, right? The mentor, we heard this morning that one of the challenges going forward is that we're going to be dealing in many cases with proxy forces if we're going to defeat this enemy. At what point, if at any point, is the ICRC right or wrong on their notion that the obligation to ensure respect for the conventions means you bear some responsibility for the forces you're working with?
Yeah, I'll start and then throw it to these two because they're smarter than I am on this stuff, I'm sure. But I would have looked more to the customary international law and really the draft articles of state responsibility for where I find my law on proxies, because it does seem like there's a rise in folks using proxy forces, the buy with and through our partners kind of thing. And Harold Coe made a speech about it and talked about, if you give direction or you have control over the forces, then you're responsible for their actions. Well, you have to be careful. That's the standard. Let's for argument's sake, let's say that's the standard. Then you have to be really careful. There's a line at which you have to decide, how far am I going to go with these proxies? Am I just going to train and equip them and then give them some broad kind of, here's what we kind of like would like you to do, and set them loose and hope they do well to avoid a charge that we're responsible for their actions, because we're not going to have any say over what they do once they go into places like Syria. As we were training the insurgent forces to go in there, we were going to lose a lot of control. So the question is, how much do you do? Do you deliberately avoid that, or do you just go ahead and take ownership of it and direction and control? And then then it's a constant responsibility to make sure they're doing the right thing, and that adds a lot. Now, we tried to do a good balance, I think, with, giving them extensive training on law of armed conflict, on human rights, on detention, even though we didn't know what they do to detain. They're out in the middle of nowhere with no facilities. But, giving them that training, but not giving them the direction and the command and the control so that they wouldn't be our forces. That's not always going to work. And sometimes you need that direction and control over proxy forces, and then you have to come up with a new strategy and new controls and measures and other things you're going to do.
I think it depends the nature of the group you're aligned with and what your role is. So, you could be have a compound in Africa where it's a local security force that's licensed by the government to do this kind of stuff. I mean, it seems to me there's a much heavier local government connection where you're reporting what went on if you see something that's out of kilter. So the difference to be you're engaging and training a local force to protect your compound in Afghanistan, and you're responsible for them. And sort of in that range, you can have a whole wide sort of types of forces. So, our forces definitely had, we called them poplets, police operational mentoring liaison teams and the and omelets with the with the Afghan National Army, and you know, these were advisors basically that were but there was a heavy reporting requirement. They weren't in command. They weren't, but if they saw something wrong, they were definitely required to report it and make sure if you know if it was in their capacity to stop it and bring it to the attention of the Afghan commander or the Afghan police commander. So, and I think a number of nations dealt with the question of abuse of Afghan boys, where you weren't aligned with the force at all, but this was happening in the compound next to you. And what was your requirement to deal with that? So it's I think it's wide-ranging. What you can't do is close your eyes to it.
Sure.
That's the...
But I mean, but Mike?
Yeah, I just want to sort of raise another example and then... a plug for one of my former colleagues at the State Department, Brian Finucane, who wrote a really good article, I think, on sort of the state responsibility and what your obligations are. And I think we were really looking more at, you know, the training and equip stuff that we were doing with Saudi Arabia and their fight in Yemen and, mm-hmm. And their ability or lack thereof to hit targets that they should be hitting and, you know, hitting hospitals and hitting other stuff. And Brian's article points out, you know, when is it incompetence and when is it they just don't care?
Don't care.
You know, and you've got to walk, I think, that fine line when you're working with them to make sure that, you know, you, you know, at some point you are going to be responsible for that. So you got to, or not.
Right.
You know, so you've got to figure out how to balance that so you don't become part of the conflict and you don't become legally responsible for what, you know, your allies are doing. So I don't go as far as what the ICRC
did. Yeah, I mean, it seems almost unrealistic to me that there's an expectation that if you provide resources to an ally or a proxy, then somehow you bear a responsibility to make an effort to make sure they're using them.
Well, I mean, you have that obligation if you look at the Arms Trade Treaty. I mean, which you know, one of the articles talks about if you know you are prohibited from transferring or selling weapons to someone that you know are going to use those to commit law of war violations. And again, it's direct knowledge,
yeah.
And you know, which is a very high bar.
Different
but I mean,
standard.
That's you know what we yeah. you know I helped write that. So I mean, that's we specifically kept it at direct knowledge. But
well,
you
yeah,
run the risk yeah. of.
Well, let's do some Q&A.
Well, one thing I did want
yeah,
to
I'm
Harold,
sorry, let's
Harold
not.
Harold Coe was careful to say general support of a proxy does not raise
right.
the obligation. So he was direct control and direction and control, yes, general support, no.
Well, look, I've always thought there's also an equity issue, right? If you don't have the disciplinary authority over the group, then imputing liability to you for something you can't prevent seems awfully inequitable
yeah.
to me. And in most of those cases, we'll never have that authority.
No, that's true.
And nor will the local or regional military officer who's working with them. I mean, he doesn't have the authority to say, if you don't stop this, the United States is going to cut off all aid to you.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
so
exactly.
Reporting it, yes. But I think there has to be a rational limit on what could be expected.
That makes sense.
Questions?
Jeff, you got one of them?
Because I see nobody else has a question to ask. General Gross, you have spoken particularly about the caution with which targeting is done now. But I didn't hear in the considerations a calculation as to the impact on the motivation of others in increasing the intensity of the activity against the United States, or in just the creation of martyrdom, which also is a beneficial aspect from their point of view. And if those would be considerations, would you ever think of considering trying to immobilize and arrest targets in order to either bring them to trial in country or to maybe even deliver them to the International Criminal Court for war crimes?
No, it's a great questions, great points. So first of all, I think commanders do consider, depending on the type of conflict and the situation, you know, they take those matters into consideration. So the tactical directive I spoke of in Afghanistan, we very much knew that, General McChrystal used to call it insurgent math. You kill two people, you may have created 10 more insurgents. I mean, it's not a one for one. And so you have to consider your actions and what it's going to do. And I've heard, you know, the martyrdom thing. I think certainly they considered that with the bin Laden raid, from my understanding, and I wasn't involved in the planning of that, so I can't say for certain. But, you know, from some of the news articles you read, they certainly considered, is he going to be a martyr? Is that going to make things worse, et cetera? So I think folks do consider those kind of things. And then your question was, remind me the second half of your question, I'm sorry. Absolutely. Yeah, the capture versus kill question. So certainly that's an important question. You know, from the PPG, for example, that we've spoken on, one of the standards in there is you have to find that capture is not feasible. That's a policy standard that is in the PPG for those types of operations. And so commanders proposing targets under the PPG in Somalia or Yemen or Libya or anywhere else would have to go through that and show that capture was or was not feasible. And then often you do try to find ways to roll folks up and detain them. There are a lot of good operational reasons, frankly, for detaining someone, to include, you know, the intelligence gain, the ability for criminal trials and so forth. So it's a consideration. It's certainly taken into account, I think, when it can be done.
Ken?
Yeah, it's back to writ large over the 9 years that I was involved with the post 9/11 conflict, was I saw a change in broad strokes from killer capture missions to capture or kill missions to arrest or kill missions, and I think that was just a indication of states starting to sort of connect the conflict with governance and with how you fight a counterinsurgency. So it's not something that necessarily is required by law, but arguably one of the it could be in terms of doing your proportionality assessment. You come to the stage you can't do a strike, and you may have to consider even a status target who you could kill. Your only option is to set up some type of operation, perhaps to try to capture them. It's in any event, that's potentially what could happen. So I think writ large, this gets down to the question of, again, where do you divide this law and policy issue? And I think too often lawyers are always saying to commanders, well, law, you can do more, you can do more, you can do more. And I think sometimes lawyers have to sit back and say, well, where are the bounds of what I'm saying you can actually do in this operating scenario? Why do I say the law can do more than the commander thinks he has to or needs to? What are the bounds of the use of force?
Well, is the PPG itself a manifestation of discomfort with the box you've opened up? I mean, specifically, the whole debate over the geography of war and transnational armed conflict, and now you lay out your framework, you've got your asserted basis for conducting operations in the territory of another state, you've got the unable or unwilling test, you've got the global strategic targeting reach, you've got it all there, and then you walk back from it in a policy memo. It strikes me that when even in the discourse of our legal authority for conducting operations outside an active theater of operations, there's still an element of legal and policy schizophrenia that's hard to avoid.
Yeah, no, I think that's fair.
One of the things I was hoping people would help me with this slide, and the PPG is included in the December 2016 in terms of by reference, so it's not like it's necessarily out of date. I'm hearing a lot of consensus on an American position being that unwilling and unable, but when I read the legal discussions that have got you there, I don't see this consensus necessarily in the legal community or certainly not in the broader international community. So we've talked about consent. There are a number of international lawyers that believe you can't do this at all because you can't use self-defense against states because they're just criminal gangs, because it violates state sovereignty, a whole bunch of reasons. And the unwilling and unable test, when it was first sort of floated as part of the drone strikes was attached to the notion of these people are involved in an ongoing armed conflict.
Right.
They're in the AUMF. And we're going to take the analogy of neutrality law to say that if the so it wasn't even a self-defense-based notion of unwilling or unable. It was a neutrality-based notion of unwilling or unable that we can strike them because the state won't, right? And there's a long history of unwilling or unable. I mean, you can go back to D.W. Ballot in 1958 where he refers to it in defense of nationals, right? So this is a different notion of unwilling and unable. And then you had, and I go back to my first comment about some question about what law applied, you had Ken Anderson's naked self-defense, which is a theory he developed because he was concerned that the administration of the time wasn't going to apply international law. And it was, as I read it, fundamentally a policy application of LOAC. And then you have Jordan.
In the execution,
right? But this raises a bigger question, too, of what law applies to when you take an act of self-defense.
In your highlighted.
In my highlighted, the third one. So you've got Jordan Paust had a robust self-defense, and he said the international community sets the bar too high for armed conflict, so we're going to apply a law under Article 51 that's basically incorporating IHL principles into it, right? So we're gap-filling. And on top of that, you have in the U.S., as you folks in the uniform know, a policy that says we apply the law of armed conflict to all international operations, right, whether they're an armed conflict or not. And the question is, that law, how do you do that?
And So, one more just to go on.
And then you've got the question of in-country self-defense. So you put states in-country, and certainly in Yemen and in Somalia, there have been arguments that it's almost like an advance to contact, and then it looks like the group's threatening you, so you justify your argument on self-defense. That's how it's played in the papers. I'm certain that's not how it happens on the ground. So my question is in this, if we go back to the first one looks like an armed conflict where it's a belligerent party. The second one looks like the individual who takes a direct part in hostilities. Those are armed conflict words. When a strike takes place outside an area of active hostilities, that's not in relation to an armed conflict, so it's not a person taking a direct part in hostilities or a person who's a party to an armed conflict, what is the law that governs the strike in terms of its execution,
right. And
does that law allow for collateral damage? And what are the standards you apply to that strike? And this is part I struggled because it looks to me like this standalone notion of self-defense has been institutionalized.
No, I agree with you, and I'd add another question. Does the proportionality principle applicable to that attack protect the deliberate object of attack?
Right.
Is it a law enforcement / human rights notion of proportionality, or is it an IHL proportion, LOAC, where once we identify you as the threat, you're not protected by proportionality?
And then the
PPG seems to complicate that even more because it suggests the former and not the latter.
And to put this in context, as I understand the debate in the United Kingdom, it's not only a question of imminence, but it's a question of the UK took strikes against two UK nationals in Syria, and that was viewed as being a hot battlefield type strike. But the debate that's been going on in the UK Parliament and elsewhere has been, if the UK is involved in providing intelligence to the U.S. forces that are carrying out drone strikes elsewhere, if they're a party to the strike, what's the legal basis for that if they take the view that that's not an armed conflict in Yemen?
Correct.
Right? Can you, and this is what their argument is, does human rights law apply to that strike? So that you would be bound by a law enforcement type notion. And so if human rights law applies, can you use a drone strike in any event, under what circumstances? So the debates sort of that come out of the PPG, I think, are there's a long way to go down the road yet before there's international consensus that the U.S. may be an outlier here.
Yes, but the question, and we've spoken about this, the question we both have when we read that is that might explain your legal authority for authorizing the operation. What rules regulate the execution of the operation? Is it LOAC rules, or is it human rights rules or norms, non-conflict norms, because you're not in the context of an armed conflict? Or once you make that decision to use military force to address that threat, have you ipso facto created an armed conflict? We, you and I have had this discussion.
I think you have to read it with the argument that the United States...
Can you make the microphone, sir, so we can get you in the recording?
Is that right?
Yeah. We have had this discussion, Geoff, and I think you have to read that last phrase. In other words, it's an act of national self-defense if the individual is deemed to be an imminent threat based on that very expanded definition of anticipatory self-defense. But I think you also have to assess it in the context of the argument that the United States makes that it's engaged in an ongoing global yet non-international armed conflict. Okay? So you have to read the two in conjunction with each other. There's your armed conflict, and that's where your law of armed conflict principles have to apply because you're engaged in this global NIAC.
So I read it a little differently. The way I read it is that the first two prongs address what you're talking about. If it's an individual who's associated with one of the groups that we've determined we are engaged in an armed conflict with, Al-Qaeda, ISIS-affiliated forces, that seems to open the door for the possibility that it's an unaffiliated imminent threat, maybe a member of Hezbollah or Hamas that we've decided is plotting some action against the United States. That individual is not within the scope of the AUMF, and yet they represent an imminent threat, and so they fall within the targeting authority as action of what Ken Anderson would call naked or self-defense targeting. But I think that that then raises the question in the execution of that operation. And we can say, well, we'll apply LOAC principles as a matter of policy. But as a matter of law, what is it? And what if you end up capturing that guy? What's his status after you capture?
Yeah, I just think it's a matter of interpretation. I can see where you're coming from, but I would link that last phrase with the NIAC and therefore the applicability of LOAC principles.
And when I heard Harold Coe give that speech at the Naval War College where he used that language, the word that jumped out at me, sir, was the word or. If the highlighted provision began with and, I'd be right with you. But why does it say or? It's distinguishing it from the first two categories, is it not?
Yeah, it does.
My question is, if it's on the context of an armed conflict, why do you need the third one at all? Yeah. And so to me, this is the one of the challenges, and it gets to the heart of the notion of what we would call pop-up armed conflicts. In other words, it's the beginning of the armed conflict. So it's outside the Tadic criteria, where it's prolonged, violent, organized armed group. In other words, we're September 10th, 2001, early morning 2011, or September 11th. At what point did the armed conflict with Al-Qaeda begin? And did it only begin, as some international lawyers would say, when the troops went into Afghanistan, or did it begin when the armed attack started on the United States?
Or would it have begun if right. we had identified that armed attack coming and taken action to stop it?
Right.
And I just think it's a manifestation of, it's almost like the unintended consequences of an expanded notion of armed conflict is that then you're struggling to kind of put You've almost gotten more than you bargained for, and you're looking for ways to put limits on it. And which is interesting to me, because if you get a different administration that doesn't want to put the limits on it, then the question becomes, what are the actual international law limits?
I guess my final comment, Geoff, would be that I think you're reading too much into war.
Okay. Any other questions?
Never had.
Thanks. Oh, great. So picking up on the very last point you made with reference to the capture question, right? So what's actually binding the administration going forward? And more specifically, what, if any, international law requirements are there for process for detainees that we pick up in the context of our global or transnational non-international armed conflict. What, if anything, does international law require that we give a captive we pick up in Yemen, Somalia, Syria, you know, take your pick outside of the places that we call, I guess, exclude hot, no, actually any of those places, right? What, if any, international law constraints? Do we have to give that guy an Article 5 hearing, something like Article 5 or not?
Well, I mean, I think that that's kind of why I asked that, I threw that question out about customary international law, because what we know if we get, I think one of the lessons that we all recognized after 9/11 is just because we've always done it that way and it's working is not a strong enough argument if you have somebody who's looking for a legal basis to deviate from that. So the question then becomes, if we pick this guy up and bring him to Guantanamo, what is the legal requirement? Hamdi doesn't provide it because Hamdi was an American citizen. Right. And even if we look what we did in Afghanistan, if we look what we did with the CSRTs, those were all anticipatory, right? DOD said, we know what the Supreme Court has said about an American citizen, so let's get ahead of the game and do this because we think it's a smart idea. But I don't think you're going to have a hard time finding a legal obligation to do much more than treat that person humanely. That, I think, would be binding on the president because we have an opinion that interprets a treaty that we're bound to. But beyond that, all that process is policy. And if the argument is made, well, there's emerging customary international law that says we have to provide a certain amount of fair process to somebody we detain, we've got the al-Bahani decision sitting there like a loaded gun that says what? That if you're operating under the AUMF, the AUMF gives you the authority to assert customary international law as a basis for action, but in no way constrains you. And then what? I think the answer to that question, Deborah, is not much other than no torture, no cruel, inhumane, and degrading treatment, maybe access to the ICRC, and that's it.
What law governs the treatment of detainees?
Process.
Process? Well, I'm an additional Protocol 1 country that would view Article 75 as customary international law, which incorporates all the human rights you would need in order to properly treat them. Right, as you do as well. And you know, that's truly been one of the advances that's come out of all this. First started with Secretary of State Clinton's discussion, but there's been a lot of DOD manuals that have recognized that, including an acknowledgement by Harold Coe that it's probably reached customary international law status.
That's where I would
come at it, you know, separate from the why in your right mind would you not do it is a separate issue altogether.
I would just
for a bunch of levels.
And I know it's just a circuit court opinion, but an en banc opinion from the D.C. Circuit in the absence of anything else from the Supreme Court has some weight. And if you haven't read the al-Bahani decision, I'd encourage you to do it because it is almost shocking in its assertion of executive power to ignore customary international law based on the authorization for the use of military force. Bob?
Hesitate to raise this, but Rich mentioned the Bin Laden raid. And it was a book called No Easy Day that came out by a SEAL who claims that he followed the lead SEAL into the room. The lead SEAL shot Bin Laden in the head. When the author entered the room, Bin Laden is on the floor, quivering in death throes, and he put a round in him. And my question is, was that not a war crime?
I mean, I worked on I helped a defense lawyer on a case out of Iraq where a captain did what I guess we would call a mercy killing. And he was convicted by a court martial. I think without having all the facts and circumstances to know the time sensitivity of the decision, who else was in the room, what else was going on, I think that the recollection of one individual who's writing a book talking about his own experience wouldn't necessarily convince me that that decision was of the same category. In that case that I worked on, there was a video feed from a drone. The victim was convulsing on the ground. The captain went like that to the medic. He fired once. He was too close because of the high-powered sight. He had to take four or five steps back. I mean, there's clear calculation there. I don't know in that. I would say in that time-sensitive situation, it'd be hard to say that there was that same level of calculation you would need to allege. And I wouldn't ask, is it a war crime? I'd ask, is it murder? It's either murder or it's nothing.
I need more facts, obviously, in that. I mean, I've read the book and read the accounts. And when I look at this stuff, I think it's a really interesting case that happened from the quite tragic killing in London, the subway case, the Charles Mendes case. The De Silva is the name of the case, though, in the European court, which was dealing with the question of if you have suicide bombers now, or your concern is you have suicide bombers, and you know the I think the British term would be a button job, where all it takes is either a finger off a button or on a button to make the bomb go off. You're driven to ensuring that there isn't that threat, and so I need a lot more. That case, in fact, found that it was an honest but mistaken belief on the part of the person that fired. It's quite an interesting read, because particularly from a human rights perspective. So I guess that's where I am on this, is the nature, and it's, you know, it's quite well known in Afghanistan, Iraq, and others that these folks wore suicide vests under their clothes, ready to stop special forces from coming into the building. And so it's the operating environment. So that's what strikes me. You need a lot more facts before you got there.
Please join me in thanking these three great panelists.